What's up, Steve Jones?
Good to see you.
How are you, mate?
I'm good.
What's going on, buddy? Opie.
Yes.
Vic Kenley.
How are you, man? I'm Vic. Nice to meet you.
How are you, man?
I like that leather hat. That's a good look.
You're happening. What's going on? Nice to meet you. Come on in.
Where am I sitting back?
Right here.
You sit right there.
The smoking pot in here.
Yeah. I'm holding.
It was just
I ain't gonna lie to you, I'm
he
holding.
He just had a container of weed open. You are correct.
Yeah, I'm a bad influence, goddammit.
Not smoking. He just opened up the container.
No, just to tease us with it.
Yeah.
Just to show us, you know,
that's a little, yeah,
his good fortune.
I think, but you're clean, yeah. Steve Jones, for a long time now,
yeah,
huh?
I can still sniff it out, though.
Yeah.
Could still smell
like
it.
Like a hound. He
but
knew
the
right
pot,
away.
Not even the pot. You're clean, zip, nothing,
nothing.
Not even.
Not even cigarettes anymore.
Nice. Oh, congratulations
I'm
on that.
I'm a bore.
Wait, how long?
That's why you wrote the book, because you had nothing to say.
Yeah.
How long sober now?
26 years.
Wow.
I was going to say 26. By the way, I read your book there, Steve Jones. The whole thing. You wrote quite a book. I liked it.
Thank you.
Liked it a lot. It's called Lonely Boy. Actually, I listened to it. I listen to books on audible.com.
Mine's on audio.
Yeah, that's how it's on my phone.
Oh, you got it?
I downloaded it, and I should say I listened to it.
With my sexy voice.
Yes. You did a very good job.
Oh, yeah, I was about to say. Yeah, that's great.
No, he did a very good job at the reading.
Nice.
Some of these guys that read their own book, oh,
it's rough.
It's a little messy.
I had the
Flavor
Flav book, yeah, on audio. It wasn't good.
It's a little messy.
Flavor Flav was really? Stumbling through sentences. I think he fell asleep at one point.
I don't want to call out anyone in particular, but there's a few that they're obviously big stars because no one was brave enough to say, maybe you should do that paragraph again. where do we begin with Steve Jones?
It's hard work doing an audio.
Yeah.
Really, yeah. Hard. It took me forever. I thought I'd just waltz through it.
Right.
Man, it took me like 60 hours.
That makes sense because the file was 9 hours and change.
Was it?
Oh, yeah.
How many hours at a time would you go in?
I was good for about 2 hours and I started like seeing things.
Yeah.
Right.
Really, and I went insane.
Yeah, but you kept your energy up through the whole thing because that you'll notice too later in these Audible books,
right.
They start tailing off. They're tired. They want to go home. So.
So you started the Sex Pistols.
Hell yeah.
Doing an audio book almost made you insane.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
You know, starting the Sex Pistols, that was a long time ago.
But, right.
You know, I'm 61 now. I was 19, 18 when that all started.
Right.
Are we on the air?
Yeah.
What do you think we're doing? You're doing radio, don't
everybody
you?
Everybody always asks
us. So relaxed.
Though,
so relaxed.
That is the number one comment that
actually,
everybody says when they walk in.
No, I mean, I'm the same. I have a show in LA.
Jonesy's Jukebox.
Yeah, I've been doing that a long time. And it's loose, too. And everyone starts swearing. It's so loose.
Right.
You can do that here.
Well, but I'm on terrestrial, so.
No, you're on satellite.
Not here now.
So you can.
No, when
oh,
I'm
yeah,
in
yeah, yeah. You're on KLOS.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
He does a very good show. And I'm a big fan of your Instagram, Mr. Jones.
Oh, thanks.
You seem like you have a really good time with that.
I have a good time with myself, yeah.
He's usually in his bathtub, in his bathroom.
Bubbles? A lot of bubbles in it?
Painting, maybe?
There's bubbles at times. Okay. There's a guitar involved. There's like spacesuits sometimes, all sorts of costumes.
Yeah.
And he sings some ditties for everybody.
Yeah, it's good. It's a good way to be creative on the...
Right.
If you're a creative person, Instagram is so good for that because you just do it I just do it with an iPhone and a tripod and some costumes and you just get creative and it's a good outlet.
He was running through a field with just his underwear on and hits an outhouse. Then he plays a character where he's like a record executive.
In a tub?
Oh, yeah, just screaming. Screaming.
I do my American New York accent in that
yes,
one.
Yes, you do. What's the character's name again? I forget.
Saul.
Yeah, Saul, right. You could have easily been on vinyl.
Yeah.
With that, easily.
Yeah.
So.
What I thought about afterwards, after I'd done it, which is always the way I kind of rush into doing these videos, I don't give it enough time.
Yeah.
But afterwards, I thought it'd been great if a chick would have come up.
At the tail end, yes.
You know what I mean?
She's got to hold her breath for the minute, though. You got a minute
cares?
On Instagram.
Who cares?
I think it's funnier if a dude
you could find
out
one.
Like
you could find one. That is somebody's got that special skill at the bottom of their resume, I guarantee you.
I think it's funny if just some butler came out of the water.
Either. anything out of the bubbles would be good. I'm on board for that visual.
So how's
But I'm with him. It's always when you're done that you think of the killer add-on.
Yeah, of course. Well, there you go. There he's on the toilet.
There you go.
Oh, you got the little steppy steps.
I got the squatty potty. I got the squatty potty.
Everybody fucking sings its praises.
It makes no difference, though, to me.
Really?
It comes out. If I'm legs around the back of my head, it still comes out.
I'm kind of with you. I haven't used mine in years.
Really?
It's still in the bathroom, though.
It kind of gets in the way, right?
Yeah, it fits around the base of the toilet. Yeah. I just kind of push it. Looks like an accessory for the toilet, I guess. I don't know.
You got to go higher. You got to go the handicap where you don't have to sit down as far.
Yeah,
you get the 18, 19 inchers. You don't even feel like you barely sit down. It's just as good, I'm telling you.
Uh-huh. Why, you got one in your house?
I know elderly people that I visit.
Well, we're all going to get there eventually. I don't want a handicap.
Nothing like shit at grandma's house.
That's right.
Right.
Very comfortable. Yeah. It's the opposite of that. That looks like a yoga pose that went wrong.
Yeah, and the other one that's becoming all the rage is the Toto one, but it has the heated seat and it goes up electrically.
Right.
And it has the water squirts up your ass after you've gone.
Right. Have you tried that?
No, I haven't. I don't know.
Good for you, Steve Jones.
It's a lot of work, you know what I mean? A lot of work.
Then it's just moist back there.
It's a lot.
Supposedly it dries it.
It dries it afterwards, too.
It sprays the front, too, don't it? Can it spray the front and the back?
It does it all.
Nice.
if it was a human tongue, I'd be into it.
There you go. Okay. Why are you looking around to see if that was okay?
She's my manager. I don't know. She's heard it all before, but I just find it funny when I say things
he's
like,
not allowed to talk anything.
I can do what I want.
I was going
to
say.
Yeah, don't worry about her. Shut up, you over there.
He doesn't get a lot of satellite radio interviews, so he can let it fly.
Let it go.
How's the book tour going in general? Are you getting sick of it?
It's hard work. I'm getting pushed around like a cheap whore,
right,
to every place in town. But it's it pays off. It sells books, and I'll be done tomorrow. I'm doing a book signing tonight at
Book Review in Huntington,
and then tomorrow New Jersey at the place, and then I'm done. Then I'll go back to LA over Friday and start back on my radio show Monday.
And they're giving you the time off? I know how they could be in radio there.
Now they're
Steve
good.
Jones.
I keep plugging them, so it's good.
All right, good. You know.
Anything super weird somebody showed up with you to sign out of the ordinary?
You know.
Tits.
You know, you get them guys.
A baby?
You get the guys with the albums.
Yeah.
With the eBay and the thing.
Has there been one thing where you're like, where the fuck did you get this? I didn't know this existed. Is there?
Nothing too outrageous.
Okay.
No.
Hmm.
But
there's no Sex Pistols board game that there were like 9 of them or something weird.
No, but that's a great idea.
Thumbs up from the manager.
I did an episode of Nevermind the Buzzcocks once on the BBC,
right.
and years later, and I did one. I'm not famous. I'm an idiot comedian, just like him.
Yeah.
I did one too.
And yeah, exactly. And someone, goddamn, 15 years later, showed up, and I'm like, I never knew there was a Buzzcocks board game.
Yeah, yeah.
Much less why do you want me fucking signing it?
I don't know.
You didn't. You didn't really leave anything out of this book, Steve Jones.
Yeah, it's pretty
pretty brave.
Okay.
Real brave. Well, I'm assuming he didn't leave anything out.
So the book is about the whole, like, the beginning, the whole...
It's more about his life.
It's three periods. It's me when I was born to the Sex Pistols, Sex Pistols, and then after the Sex Pistols. It's like three parts, really.
Are you an only child or something? Or?
I'm the only child,
felt that. I felt the vibe on you. Felt it.
You want to feel the vibe? He had a rough childhood.
Being an only child is like a bad and good thing at the same time. It's like being a rock star with two fans.
Yeah.
Well, Sherrod, it's okay until the mom gets a new boyfriend.
Oh, did he hit you?
No, he molested me.
Jesus. I guess that's the worst hit of all.
Only once, but it was enough to spin me out, you know?
Out of control.
How old were you?
10.
Fuck.
And then the mom, Steve Jones' mom, stays with the dude. For how long?
She didn't know, in her defense. I don't think she knew about it.
Right.
She didn't know about it, but she wasn't the best mom. She was kind of cold. Not very nurturing. I was, you know, I got in the way, you know, to be true. My mum and my real dad, you know, they were teddy boys, which was like, you know, rockabilly types.
Sure.
And they met and had me, and my mum kept me, and he split. And then you know what it's like when single mums have a child. A lot of dudes that ain't interested.
Right.
So you kind of make do with whatever you get, and she made do with this horrible person. You know?
Fuck. And how long were they together? I think he died
forever until he died around 2007, 2008.
So that made it tough to have a relationship with your mom because you didn't want to tell her what happened, obviously.
I sent him a letter once, and it came back full of denial.
So it was red?
Supposedly.
Okay.
You know, I don't know the truth, but it's all good, man. I mean, you know, like I said, there's a positive to that. It made me angry.
Right.
It made me drive more to get out of the shithole I was living in and to get away with that. And it really did have a lot to do with me wanting to start a band, an angry band, like the Sex Pistols.
So are you trying to tell the kids out there if they want to start a band?
Get molested.
Can I jot that down? Let me jot that down so I won't forget
And the publicist's eyes roll again. I just noticed.
The manager.
There'll be some twitching by the end of the interview.
But you got to use it as fuel. You use it as fuel.
Of course. It will destroy you.
Yeah.
Do you ever get over that happening to you?
Well, I think the hardest thing that I'm getting over is the fact that my mum didn't really want to have a kid. I think that was more than me getting fiddled by.
Right.
Him.
Right.
You know, because I just can't have relationships. I'm only attracted, and I know you've heard this a million times, to birds who don't want me.
Yeah.
You know, as soon as I get the ones who want me, I'm done.
Right.
You know, and that is a hard chain to break.
Right.
You know, it don't matter how hard I try, so I don't bother now. I'm 61. I'm kind of, I've just resigned to being by myself. And I have a decent life, you know. On the other hand, there's a lot of people who get married who have divorces and have kids, and it's a mess.
Right.
You know, so I'm making do with what I've got.
Yeah, you were never married. And your relationship with your mom was just...
Yeah, I haven't spoke to her for a long time.
What I also found fascinating in the book was you don't really go back to England. You want it out of there.
Yeah.
Yeah, fuck those red coats, right?
Yeah, them bleeding limers.
Bleeding limers.
By the way,
ask him what he thinks about the Queen. There's a whole song about that one.
I didn't even go back for my book.
Oh really?
Seriously?
Yeah.
No kidding.
I just don't like going there. It's a long way.
Yeah, but you can sell a lot of books over there.
It's probably doing well over there.
It's already, so you don't even need to. Well, I'm sure it would help, but it's doing good there.
Right.
But I just hate going back there.
Right. Is it the distance, or is it just the vibe you get when you get
back? It's a few things. It's the distance. It's a lot of people I don't want to see come out of the woodwork. It just depresses me. You know, growing up there, looking back on it, you know, I was in a kind of funk for many years. And it just, when I go back, it just reminds me of being in that funk. And it's changed a lot as well. It ain't like what I remember as a kid. It's very crowded and expensive. And
there was also a local pedo that might have, you know.
There's a lot of them everywhere. Yeah.
Well, over there?
Well, he had
I had a little thing with a Peter.
Part two.
There's another one?
Yes.
He was just a sexy little boy, huh?
I guess I gave off that energy.
Good looking.
It's the hunger.
It was the local pedo and then the, mom's new boyfriend. Oh, that's unbelievable.
So the local pedo was first?
No. Well, it's funny. It's a weird story. When I was really young, when I was living with my nan, when I was at a good relationship, my nan was very nurturing. It was all normal. It was me, my nan, my mum, and my granddad living in, and my mum's sister. We were all living in this flat, a nice flat. It was all loving. And I moved out when I was six with the horrible guy, and that's when it all changed. But prior to that, there was this guy when I was playing with all the kids down in the square in the block, and he would get a dirty magazine and break off pieces of paper, and he'd lure me away, and I would go after looking at these pictures at 6 years old of naked women, you know.
It's like Hansel and Gretel, but with porn.
And he got me kind of far away, but then we went under this underpass, and he was like, I remember seeing him down the other end, and I just thought, like, this ain't right. you know, and I had normal common sense at that point.
Yeah.
So I just left and went back. And then after that, you know, a few years later, after the thing with the stepfather, who do I run into?
Oh,
the paedophile. He's around again. And what did he do? He gave me some money and he sucked me off.
Wow.
He wasn't very good.
To suck off?
That's what he meant.
That's
yes.
A that's but, a
yeah, teethy.
It was all
Teddy's a teethy.
It was all twisted at that point, you know.
Right.
I mean, I was confused. I'm not gay, but it completely confused me about everything the thing the stepfather did. They have no idea what damage they're doing to kids. It's so fucking selfish.
I don't think they care.
No, they don't.
When you talk about that in the book, and you know, there's a good moment where it's obvious you got the power back and got to see like your mom's boyfriend and realize that he's just a feeble old
just
man now.
Pathetic, yeah.
Because I'm sure for many, many years you're looking at this guy like
he's a monster. Like
yeah, he's a monster that could hurt me at any time.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, but that led him to leaving the house at an early age. The Sex Pistols started when you were 18, 19.
Yeah, around there.
Can you explain the stealing? Do you still like to steal?
No.
Dude, this book is great. I mean, he doesn't hold back.
What'd you steal? You stole everything?
Everything that wasn't nailed down.
That's my kind of thief, yes. Absolutely.
But he's in bands and they need equipment.
Of course.
He would walk in and make believe he's a roadie and just grab whatever the hell he wanted from the stage.
Why not?
It's kind of brilliant, actually, Steve.
Yeah.
It's kind of brilliant.
If you go in like you belong and you have a job, they'll just like you.
You start throwing shit over your shoulder.
You got an accent. You're going to let him walk out with it.
But he would steal from bands he was a fan of.
Didn't matter.
No mercy.
Who's the biggest band you might have stole something from?
I guess there was many that's not even in the book. It just gets boring after a while.
But
I didn't find it boring at all.
Somebody, give me one or two.
No, David Bowie.
Okay. That does get much bigger than that.
Come on, somebody else. One more.
Roxy Music.
Okay.
And you like them, I thought. Weren't you?
I like all of them.
It seems like you like their stuff more.
Yeah. What did you like more, Roxy Music or their amps?
It was
that's
good.
Incredible.
It was good.
Where'd you steal from Bowie? Do you remember?
It was his last farewell tour when they were the Spiders from Mars.
Right.
At Hammersmith Odeon. And I was like 15, 16. And they played. They did their first night.
Good.
They did the first night. They left all the gear set up. And this place, it was the Hammersmith Odeon, which is now the Hammersmith Apollo. It's still there. Bands still play there. But I knew this place like the back of my hand. And I was like the Phantom of Hammersmith Odeon. I was getting the rafters, in the rafters, everywhere.
Did you have a mask?
I had a cloak of invisibility. So they left a roadie on like the fifth row, and I just waited till he fell asleep.
Yeah.
And he was snoring, and I snuck on there with some wire cutters, got a load of these beautiful Neumann mics. I got the drummer's cymbals, the bass player's head, and I got Bowie's. I wish I still had this. Bowie's microphone, it, like this little Electro Voice, but it had his lipstick on the end of it.
Oh, my God. That could have bought my mother a house.
Where did that go?
Right.
I have no idea.
No idea.
Oh. No kidding.
But you get off on stealing, or it did.
I did.
When you were growing up.
Yeah.
Did you connect it to sex or...
I connected to just filling a hole.
Feeling a hole.
It wasn't even really about getting stuff. I mean, like it was more about having somewhere to go.
Right.
Every day, it was a mission I had to be on. I couldn't sit still, and I was self-medicating is what I was doing.
Right.
In order to deal with the stepdad thing, you know.
What, drinking and drugging back then?
Well, that came next.
Okay.
The stealing when I was a teenager. And let's not leave out, I used to like Pete Peeping Tommy too.
He's like Peeping Tom.
Yeah.
You're like voyeur.
Yeah.
Yeah, but me too, you freaky bitch.
Most
I love
of us
you.
Like that. when you come upon something like that, you're stopping and watching.
Oh, I peek. Even if I hear peek. It, I'm a voyeur even when it comes to ears. I'm in a hotel and I hear moaning. Oh. Everything's down. And you I turn the lights down. I'm like, I can't even hear over the lights.
You got to get ready. And then you put the glass up against, right?
Yes.
You go glass?
I go glass.
Go glass against the wall.
I like hearing and seeing things I shouldn't.
Is that a bad thing to be into peeping Tom?
Well, I used to go into these buildings and try to watch girls have baths and have a shit and all that. One time.
That's two ends of the spectrum there, by the way.
Don't look at her. That means this is the good stuff.
He keeps turning
no
around.
No offense to you. This is the good stuff.
This
Don't look
gold.
At her. Right.
I mean, even the, I was so embarrassed once, it's in the book, that I was peeping Tom in, and someone must have called the cops. The cops showed up, and I quickly put it away and made that I was breaking in the house.
Oh God!
Because I was too embarrassed
to be out there jerking off. So you pretending like you were stealing.
Right.
I was breaking in the
regular
place,
criminal didn't be peeping Tom.
He's like, no, I'm an arsonist.
Just a thing, right? Exactly. Right. I was going to murder the bitch.
That is too hilarious.
But that's the distinction, I guess, with peeping Tom. I mean, you can't be, you know.
I mean, everyone's a peeping Tom now on the internet.
Yes.
You know?
Right.
It's our whole culture. Everything is built around it.
Right.
You can see the first ladies. For the first time in American history, hearing about, we have a first lady that you can be a peeping Tom.
Yeah,
I don't believe this ever existed.
And see her nudes.
Anything.
But you can't trespass is what I'm, I guess what I'm getting at.
Well, that's
where, that maybe is where you're, you know, crossing the line a little bit.
Go into, you know, public toilets and look over the wall.
That's you would do that? You.
Yeah.
Just out of the blue?
With one hand.
Focused.
And they say Ringling Brothers is closed.
And drill the holes.
Drill the holes.
You drilled some holes, right?
I didn't drill the holes. I just, there was always a lot of hills already drilled.
Yeah.
And a lot of toilets. I wasn't the only one doing this, obviously, you know.
Right. Man.
Wow. You had to pick the hole that's right for you.
Do you, so you're sober, but do you still steal from time to time?
No.
How long has that been?
About 30 years since I lost.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, do you remember the last thing you stole and you were like, I'm done?
No. I mean, the kleptomaniac stopped kind of around and the pistols time, but I still did a little bit of stuff here and there, but totally everything, you know, like 30 years ago.
Ever
like,
get caught?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Wait, really? Like, what's something bad? Like, go to jail, caught? Come with me, please?
Yeah, most of it was all juvenile stuff, though.
Oh, okay.
I went away for a year and a half in this one place.
Shit.
Was in another couple of places, boys' homes, and...
What's that like in England? It's supposed to be just brutal over
Isn't
here.
Isn't it as sexy as we think it is? All those boys crammed in a mansion.
Running around Hogwarts, learning wizardry.
I think it's worse here in the penitentiaries. I think I actually watched a documentary on that when I first came to the States, and it caught my attention. You know,
yeah, but yeah, the early days of the Sex Pistols, they needed some equipment, and Steve Jones, you know, made sure they were well equipped.
I'm sure that's not the first man in that nicked some stuff,
right?
Now
to go all English with my vernacular,
I'm
sure Bowie stole something. I've
read over the
from
years
her native
from
land.
My people.
I've read over the years, and that's certainly in the book. You guys didn't really get along in general, huh?
No, not
here we go.
No, not really. I mean, it was. It doesn't matter. It's a band, you know. You're not really. You don't have to get along. A lot of bands don't get along. You get along at first before you're known. And you're kind of like a little team.
Yeah.
But then, you know, then as soon as you get a bit of success, it all starts going to pot. Everyone's egos, you know, gets involved. It seems the common theme, whether it's the Beach Boys,
absolutely,
Sex Pistols, it's all the same shit.
The Stones.
It's all the same shit.
Everly Brothers.
All the same.
Run DMC. But I just wanted to add something.
But you guys understand you're strong as a unit and it's a business, so you kind of like coexist.
Yeah.
We've had Johnny Rotten in here a couple times. I can't figure him out.
How was it?
Uh-oh.
When was the last time?
Last year? Probably a year ago.
Was he doing his book?
Yeah. I don't know. Does he like to have fun ever?
I think that he acts when he's in public with because he's very insecure. I think it's all driven from that fear and insecurity.
Every once in a while, we would get a little smile starting in the corner of his mouth, and then you could see him just shutting it down and putting up this, like, wall.
Yeah, he can't let go of the past, you know.
A friend of mine ran into him somewhere. It was like at a ski resort at a bar, and he didn't know who he was. So he talked to him for like an hour and a half, and then later on he realized that's who he was talking to. Since he didn't know it was him, he said he couldn't have been more lovely and was really sweet. Is that possible?
It's possible.
Something like that?
It's totally possible. You say the wrong word, it can turn on
a dime. Oh, in a second.
Yeah, my buddy totally had no idea, and he thinks later on when my other friends were reminding him, hey, Jackass, do you know who you were talking to? And he said, well, he couldn't have been friendlier for somebody named Rotten.
What in the past do you think he can't let go of? What's in the past that he's holding on to?
I just think he has to act a certain way. He can't just let it all go, you know, and just try and enjoy yourself. I mean, I don't want to say what he is and what he ain't. That's how I perceive it, you know.
Right.
You know, we're 60. I'm 61. He's 60.
Right.
What's the point of acting like a 20-year-old, like a child?
I agree.
It seems stupid.
Right. You don't want to be the last old dude up in the club.
We come in here and do it and get it out of our system.
Of course.
And then go back to the regular world and try to.
Yeah, he's not making Instagram videos like Steve Jones.
He's not having a good old time.
No.
He's not.
You're on high alert. You know, at any second, he could just completely snap.
Yeah.
I got that vibe.
Really?
Immediately.
Well, that's what he just said.
Immediately.
Yeah.
But like, really hard to figure out, though. I couldn't figure out where he was coming from. I don't know if it was like fake anger or a persona or. I don't know what it was. We had him on twice. It was the same thing.
I think he's more worried that he's going to look stupid. You're going to make him look stupid. So he don't let you make him look stupid.
Right.
You know? I tell you, he's not afraid to look stupid. You worked with Russell Brand. That guy, he doesn't care one bit.
No,
he just
don't care.
Silly and fun and amazing.
Yeah, he's fun.
I like Russell Brand.
Me too.
What was that like?
Working with him?
Yeah.
It was short-lived on FX. I was like his one-man band.
And
the trouble with Russell is he's really intelligent bloke.
Yeah.
He really is intelligent, but he's not a good interviewer. He'll ask someone a question, he don't even let him finish. You know, and then he's on to something else. He gets more hype and his voice goes up. And to me, it just gets a bit dull after a while.
Right.
That's what Katy Perry said.
What was your relationship with
Sid? You that
word for word.
What was your relationship with Sid?
I didn't really know Sid. I liked him. I thought he was a fun guy. You know, he wasn't equipped for what was going on. Got thrown in the deep end.
Left his mark, and it was a groupie from America.
From New York.
From New York, Nancy. Yep.
What about her?
Sid and Nancy.
Yeah,
watch that movie.
Who he had sex with.
You had sex with which one, Sid or Nancy?
Sid. I mean Nancy.
Got him! Exclusive. Make the video. Get it out.
It's the one time he didn't turn around and check to see if it was okay.
She wasn't a good vibes. It was dark energy.
Really?
With her. And it was all about heroin, you know, that whole scene. I hadn't discovered heroin at this time. Well, I hadn't got involved in it anyway.
Yeah.
And that was a dark period. And I don't know what that relationship was all about. There's obviously some pact that they had. I think they both said they want to kill themselves.
How old were they?
Young, 21. He was the youngest. Sid, yeah.
Do you ever see the film, The Oldman?
Gary Oldman.
It's great. It's a wonderful film. Yeah.
I've interviewed him a few times as well, Gary Oldman, and he said prior to doing that, he hadn't ever done any films. He'd just done plays where he never made any money, and he didn't want to do it. He said the only reason he did it because he got offered a lot of money for his standards.
Right.
That's why he did it.
Huh.
Wow.
People are asking the name of the books. I think we're doing our job. It's Steve Jones' Lonely Boy, Tales from a Sex Pistol.
Did you ever think you'd be 61? You couldn't. Like when you was 19, 22.
It seemed ancient.
Right. It seemed like
people who are 30 seemed ancient when you're 21, you know? So, yeah, I don't know why I'm still here. I shouldn't be here. And I hate being cliched, but, you know, I shouldn't be here. When I was like a kid, before drugs and all that, I used to get in weird situations. I should have ended up in the back of some van and been doing bondage films, you know what I mean?
That's low budget. That's extremely low budget.
And disappear.
Right,
it happens all the time, and I was always by myself. I never had any parental guidance or crazy. No one was looking out for me.
Sure. These first bands, I remember when Mick Jagger turned 40, they're like, he's over the hill, it's over.
Yeah.
30, how many years later? They're still...
30 years later.
Trying to do it.
And that last blues record doesn't suck by a long shot. That's some good shit on there, absolutely.
Speaking of music, I get the feeling from the book that you were hoping maybe the band would have been a little different than just a punk band. And I was it's like a two-parter or adding to this. And your influences were very interesting to me. It was Bowie, it was Roxy Music, I wrote it down, Rod Stewart and Faces, yeah. Both when Rod Stewart wasn't with Faces and when he was with Faces, and the New York Dolls. So.
Yeah, and the Stooges.
And the Stooges. Yeah. But Roxy Music, I was surprised to hear.
Really?
Especially. And David Bowie.
Well, their first two albums.
Wow.
When I was 14, that was what was going around. And there's a lot of guys like me, they were all into the glam rock, you know. There was kind of two kinds of like glam rock. There was bands like Bowie, Mark Bolan, Roxy Music,
right.
And the Faces. And there was a lot of shit glam rock too. And they were like the more intellectual glam, if you will, better songwriting. And there was some stupid ones too that were terrible, but...
Yeah,
I knew the difference. You know, I liked what I liked. They were more stylish, Roxy Music. The first Roxy Music, if you listen to it, it's very kind of punky.
I think after reading this book, I want to go deeper with Roxy Music. I don't know much about Roxy.
Albums.
Albums. Exactly. And because Vic was telling me in England, Roxy Music was huge.
Yeah.
Oh, they're very revered. Yeah, sorry, Steve.
They only really started making it here when they had that song More Than This,
right.
Avalon, when and it was Avalon. All mellow chicks liked it, you know. But
yeah, that's all I really know. I can't.
Slave front. To Love and out. Yeah, he's right. But but there's some real good early.
I might have to go on YouTube later tonight and check out some Roxy music. But were you hoping the band would have done a little differently as far as maybe moving out of the punk?
No, I mean. The reason that it sounded the way it did was lack of technability, you know. I mean, I'd only been playing a few months.
Right.
So that I was limited for what I could do. And Rotten's never sung before, and he sounded the way he sounded.
Right.
And I think, lyrics are fantastic.
Right.
Fantastic lyrics from a young guy to write them words, Anarchy in the UK and God Save the Queen. And all the other songs, they were really intelligent lyrics.
Yeah.
And you know, the power underneath it just kind of, that's what it was. I just thought we were in a rock band.
Right.
You know, I mean, the tempos are like rock tempos. It's not like too crazy fast and all that stuff. You know, I thought we were kind of just another rock band.
Right. And did you guys start the spitting?
It supposedly started from John. He always says that he had like meningitis or something. He's always singing, coughing, spitting from singing. You know, right. I guess some kids saw it and thought that was what you had to do.
Right. But didn't someone get hepatitis or get sick from
Joe Strummer supposedly got sick from it.
At a Sex Pistols show?
No, in the Clash.
I know it's for the Clash. But didn't he opened his mouth and
got, a big one went in there.
Was somebody spit right in his mouth?
Yeah, who spit in his mouth, I guess?
Just a fan. Just
oh, it was a fan. Okay, I misunderstood
that's
that
in
the book.
That's a fan? Who's an enemy?
There's a whole thing going on.
No, because the fans started thinking, oh, this is what
this
you
is
want.
The thing you want. Yeah.
So I'm going to spit on you while you're singing. And then he opened his mouth, and he got a loogie in there, and supposedly got pretty damn sick.
Yeah.
Oh.
But everyone used to do it.
What concert is this?
It's funny. Sometimes I used to see some concerts a bit later on. The guys would come out, and literally it was like a hail of... arrows being
we'll loogie. Fight in the shade.
Yeah.
300
spears of phlegm.
Yeah.
We'll fight in the shade.
And how long was the run at first? Like 3 years?
About that, yeah.
And then you guys got back together many years later for a tour.
1996 was the first time.
And it didn't seem to go too well.
Well, it was a long tour. We did like 100 shows.
Right.
It was about a year, and we were sick of each other.
Yeah, you didn't ease back in.
It was the first time I actually made some dodo.
Oh, really?
So that was a good thing.
Actually, yes. In the book, I'm thinking, Steve Jones from the Sex Pistols, after the Sex Pistols, I'm thinking, he's got enough money to live. You didn't really, you had no money.
Not from the beginning, no.
Wow.
And we only have one album.
Right.
You know, it's not like we're living off 10 albums,
right.
Publishing and all that stuff.
And why did you decide to move to L.A.? Out of all places.
I just kind of drifted out now. I left London with another band after the Sex Pistols, a band called The Professionals.
Right.
And we drifted out doing clubs. I was kicking dope and I was always getting drunk and doing blow. We got to New York. The guy who was our bodyguard wanted to beat me up.
Just for good measure or to coach the straight?
No, because he was in his own cirrhosis doing blow and paranoid. And it was just, you know, it was a mess. And I said, I'm not going back to England. I'll see you later.
That was it.
And I didn't go back. I sold my passport. And I,
you sold your passport?
I didn't have any money. And I hooked up with a lady of the night who was a junkie. And I lived with her for a little while. Then
holy shit.
And her name was Steve Jones too?
No. and met another chick later, right, who was a kind of a social butterfly, and me and her lived together for a little bit and then drifted out to LA, and I've been there ever since.
Pretty amazing.
Wow.
And only bought a house relatively recently considering, right?
Yeah.
Finally settled down a little bit.
A little bit, yeah. After that one big tour, I made enough dough to, you know, get a down payment on a place.
I haven't been in LA. You know, well, not as much as I used to, I guess is what I should say. But every time I was out there, I would search out you on the radio. This guy knows how to do radio. Well, what did you always love? Radio or broadcasters, yapping, or like, how did that come about?
It was a real fluke. I was driving around in my car, you know, flicking the channels, and all of a sudden I come across this one channel and they were playing punk music and there was no commercials. I didn't realize at the time they just started, and of course there was no commercials. Yeah. But I'm like, this is cool. And 2 weeks after that, so I was hip to the station, this guy called me up and says, listen, there's this new station. Can you do some IDs for it? Because we kind of like punk music. Be good having your name. Hi, this is Steve Jones. You're listening to blah, blah. Before I got to that, I said, I want to be a DJ. And they were like, I said, yeah, please. Can I be a DJ? I had nothing going on. And the two guys who were kind of running it at the time, this was like right at the bottom. Nothing was happening with this station. It was a Spanish station. They just tried doing a different thing.
Right, yeah.
And they said, okay, yeah, come and do an hour a day, 5 days a week. And I said, just let me do what I want to do and play what I want to play. And they're like, all right. They didn't care because there was nothing riding on it.
They had
right?
nothing to lose.
There was no ratings. There was nothing.
We're talking about Indie 103.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it just kind of, you know, I was buffooning around. I had no idea what I was doing, but people seemed to like it. You know. And I got better at my buffoonery after a while. And that went on for like 5 years, and it became a cool thing. Everyone used to love that station.
Absolutely.
Wow. It's a tiny little signal.
Right.
But, it, you know, people dug it.
Right.
And it kind of, the station dissolved in 2008.
Why did it dissolve?
I don't know. I think there was, you know, the big crash. I think it might have had something to do with it.
Oh, sure.
It was costing too much money to run it. It would have been, and they just flipped it back to another Spanish station with no people there.
Right.
People were bummed, man.
A lot of
people were bummed.
And then did you take time off before you went to KLOS?
Yeah, I took a little few months hiatus.
Yeah.
I went to K-Rock for 2 years, just on a Sunday night. But it's no good. No one listens to the radio on a Sunday night anymore.
Right.
And then that ended. And then I got a phone call a year ago from the lady who was the GM at Indy. Who worked at, she keeps taking me wherever she goes.
Nice.
And now she's my biggest fan, Dawn DeRocco. She's sure. a sweetheart. And she's got me in there over there. And same thing, doing what I want, playing what I want, saying what I want.
It's a blessing.
And he is beloved. Everyone does this show.
That's where I was going to go. Is there anybody super big that you were just thrilled to get, and anybody super big that you hadn't gotten yet?
Well, Dave Grohl and Taylor Hawkins filled in for me yesterday.
You son of a bitch.
Not only did
you watch Sonic Highways, by the way?
No? Yeah,
did
yeah.
That, which was outstanding.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's big names.
Yeah. There they are.
That was a week ago when I was there, and that was the day my book came out. They came on to support me.
Fuck,
that's pretty cool.
And what he did yesterday, he did the whole 2 hours in my accent, like he was making out he was jungle.
No,
he just went ahead and went with it. Yeah. That's cool.
It's good.
That's cool as shit.
Now, saying that, now anybody that you hadn't gotten yet.
Johnny Depp came on.
Who are you looking for? Who's your dream get so far? Who hadn't done it?
Sherrod. I'm available. If you...
Johnny Depp just shows up. How cool is that, man?
Did he have weed on him?
I don't know. Uh-huh. I don't know. But I have a lot of guests. A lot of people want to come on there because it's fun. It's loose. You know, it's like your deal. It's just loose.
Right.
You know, and you're not feel pressured to...
You're hugging a goat in one of those pitches? What was that?
But unfortunately...
Was there a goat?
Steve, I got to play the other side of that. There's so many people in management that will not... They'll hire personalities and then tell them to shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
And not let them do what they're capable of doing. So we're kind of lucky that we get to just... You know, shoot the shit like this.
Yeah, and you know, play music I want to play, like deep cuts or new bands I play to.
Right.
It's fun. I couldn't do it any other way. It'd be pointless.
Yeah.
Just talking in amongst someone else's playlist.
So are you Instagramming on this book tour?
I haven't done anything. The last thing I did was
Donkey?
Seth Myers.
Looked like a burrow.
I went on his show two days ago. Yeah.
Right.
That was good. And the donkey.
Yeah, what was that about?
That was in Aspen a few days ago.
A miniature donkey, right? Is that a...
Is it a burro or is it just a little donkey? Then
Juanita, I think her name is. No, seriously, that's what they call
her. Oh, she's Spanish.
Juanita. Yeah. My sweet Juanita.
She was such a sweet animal. Yeah. She just come over and just wanted to cuddle you.
Oh.
She's trying to get on the show.
She is. Right now.
Mission accomplished.
So would you Facebook Live? Is that what you do? What do you do as far as cameras?
I usually, we got cameras running all the time, and then we'll throw some stuff on YouTube every day.
Yeah.
And then after the show, we'll do a little Facebook Live, you know.
Yeah.
And then I Instagram Live a little bit right before the show.
Yeah.
As we're setting up and, you know, just shooting the shit, saying hi to everybody that's coming in for the day.
How many hours do you do?
Quick three now, man. Yeah. It's easy. This is a piece of cake.
So good.
Right. So
5 days a week?
Sometimes
I've been around a while. I got a nice cushy gig.
Yeah. He owns like 12 homes. Seriously, there's 12 homes. If you count the guest houses on the four main properties, it's actually 12 homes.
Let's just put it this way: I might have taken a little too much time off in the summer. Yeah. I don't think I was here in August, and they started noticing for the first time. Like, where have you been? I'm like, what, man? I'm enjoying the summer.
Yeah. The outhouse at the one down in Charleston, South Carolina, is a former slave cabin.
Yeah, that's right.
I wouldn't say former. Well, okay. I stay there sometimes when I go down.
I knew he renovated it for you.
Right.
Now, when was the first time you performed like outside of England?
The first time outside of England was we went to Paris on my 21st birthday.
Oh, shit. What happened?
Well, Malcolm McLaren bought me some heroin and got me a hooker.
Is that not lyrics to your next song?
which is pointless because when you do dope, you're not interested in sex, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Definitely not heroin.
And it was the first time I did it, actually, and I threw up and... I didn't like it at that point.
But it didn't stop you from continuing.
I mean, I didn't get into it right then. I really only got into it after the band broke up.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
How was that performance, too, performing in Paris that first time?
It was a bizarre show. It was great, actually. We played at this weird disco, and there was a lot of people were into it.
Right.
It was the first time I've ever been on a plane. It was a big day, you know, for me.
Wow. Are you from London? You're from...
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
West London.
Whereabouts?
Hammersmith.
All right. Who's your football team?
Chelsea.
There you go.
Oh, you knew right away. Chelsea.
There were other choices I was thinking of, but I figured he was going to go Chelsea.
Did he pick a good one?
Did he pick a good one? Yeah.
I'm trying. Would you go back for a Chelsea game?
Oh, yeah.
There we go. That'll bring him home.
That would. If I did go back, if I had to go back and it was in season, I'd be there in every game I could.
Right. Got to just make sure the pedo's gone.
Yeah.
He can beat the shit out of the pedos now.
Now, man.
Right. You took the power back, right, Steve Jones?
Yeah.
He goes, yeah.
Sounds like it to me.
Yeah. I don't know. There's a lot of people out there that had to deal with that shit.
Most people.
Every town has a few of them, man.
Yeah, right. every family has a few of them.
Yeah.
Sadly.
It's more common than you know.
Oh, we all know now because of the app. You put your address in and you see all the dots in your neighborhood. You're like, what the fuck?
I don't even fuck with it. Definitely in New York, is they in your building. Right. You can't not.
But it's worse when it comes from where you live. You know, that's what's worse.
Yeah.
Because you don't feel safe.
At home.
Yeah. If, you know.
Ugh. It's a bad feeling, man. That's some selfish shit to do to a kid.
Ugh.
Right.
What a way to end this interview.
Way uplifting. Everybody go home and watch Spotlight again. In case we haven't been sad enough, just go ahead. Watch the Meryl Streep one where Philip Seymour Hoffman, then go into Spotlight.
Is that Doubt? What is that?
Yeah, Doubt, thank you. And then just close it off. What's the one about the laundries over in Ireland? That one's also god awful. The Magdalene Sisters. Let's just go go for that trifecta of child slavery and pedophilia, if you
but
really
the next
wanna.
Kurt Cobain is out there.
What?
We learned from Steve Jones.
Yeah.
That's what got him into the band.
Right. What about that? Yeah. Did you see that documentary a little while ago? The kid that was the first kid on the milk carton?
It's the dude, John Walsh's son, Adam.
Yeah.
He started.
Oh, Adam,
I am Adam. My name is Adam. Yeah. Maybe.
And he got taken off to a sex slave thing, right?
His head got, he got decapitated.
Yeah.
John Washington. Yeah.
Supposedly they killed he got killed a mere block or two away from where he was abducted.
Yeah.
He had a paper round, right? We talking about the same one?
Maybe. I'm not really sure.
America's Most Wanted.
One, who the took Johnny?
The guy that started.
Yeah, that's the kid. That's it. That's the documentary.
Oh, that's a different one. Yeah.
Oh, this is different.
Yes.
That is a great documentary.
Gotta watch this.
And his mother's in it trying to, find the it's a great. It's definitely worth watching.
Should we drop Dear Zachary on him?
No, God, no.
Oh, don't ever see Dear Zachary. Don't ever watch Dear Zachary.
Who?
It's a documentary called Dear Zachary that'll just
forget he said that.
You're gonna cry.
Forget he said that.
It's awful.
It sounds awful.
It's brutal.
It's wonderfully done.
It's a good watch though. They made it, but it's heavy.
Yes.
You're not gonna. I don't know if you can see a heavier documentary than Dear Zachary.
Atlas is juggling a Nerf ball.
It's on Netflix still, right?
It's out there.
I think it is.
Yeah, I think it is.
We brought a guitar in here. Can you play anything on the way out? Maybe an Instagram type of deal?
Sure, I can.
Do we have any costumes? Sure.
What do you want to hear? I'll play it. Yeah, oh, him?
Sherrod. Oh, she's saying yes.
Sherrod's going to
play. Yes!
Because I became, when I was doing research for this interview and reading the book, I became an instant fan of your Instagram. It's called Jonesy's Jukebox, I believe, right?
Yeah.
You gotta go there. It's some weird shit, though, man.
I gotta watch. Really?
Yes, there it's weird.
I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just.
Sounds nice.
Yeah.
You sing?
No, I'm just black.
Rap then.
I definitely can't rap. I'm not that black. I'm right in the middle of those two. I'm R&B and hip hop.
To go, so here I go to Long Island.
Huntington.
That's awesome. That's beautiful, bad, man. The book review. The book review in Huntington. That's my hometown, Steve Jones. Enjoy Huntington. Yeah, it's a great bookstore too.
Oh, cool.
I think
Mariah Carey's from there as well.
Yeah.
If you whisper her name, sometimes she appears.
Really? <That's right. laughs> And where's the book signing tomorrow in Jersey?
Bookends.
Oh, I got it.
Is it Bookends?
Oh, I'm sorry. I should do this for you. Yeah, Bookends, Ridgewood, New Jersey tomorrow.
Nice.
At 7 o'clock. Book review tonight on Long Island in Huntington. And then Book Soup in West Hollywood later this month, January 28th.
Yeah.
Nice.
It was a pleasure meeting you, Steve Jones.
Definitely.
You wrote a very good book, very open. I appreciate that. Because a lot of celebrities that write books, man, they leave everything out.
They hold back.
Oh, it stinks.
The phony balonies.
Right.
There's a picture of him as a little kid with a monkey on his head, and he wrote, "He's enjoying eating the head lice off of me." One of the funniest things. That's how far along I've gotten. I've gotten till the middle. Okay. And I just flipped over and saw that page, and he's like, "This monkey's really enjoying a free snack off the lice on my head."
Nice.
That's hilarious.
And a lot of pictures, too. Oh,
that's what I mean. It's in pictures. There. Yeah, it's totally. It's, yeah. So,
I got to get that book.
Yeah, I'm about halfway in. That's about how far I got to the picture.
BOC. Don't fear the Reaper.
Don't smoke the Reaper.
He just had it out earlier.
Yep.
Oh, one other thing really fast. The Who. Who are you? Really about you or the whole band?
No, it's just about me and Cookie.
Isn't that cool?
We met him one night out at a club, and he was really drunk.
Pete Townsend, right?
Yeah,
yeah.
And he'd been at it all day. He was, you know, he was business meetings all day, and I guess he just started drinking. It was one of them ones where he just got tied one on, and we met him in a nightclub. And he was talking to everyone who kind of bumped in. Who the fuck are you? Who are you? That's what all he kept saying all night.
Right.
And then he run into me and Cookie, and he like came to and just started picking our brains for about 2 hours. He sobered up because he was hip to the Sex Pistols, and we're kind of from the same area, Shepherd's Bush, Hammersmith. And then he actually said later that song was based on meeting us.
Wow. Cool. One of their greatest songs, right?
Oh, shit, yeah.
Didn't get much bigger than that. Look at Fooled Again.
Who the fuck are you?
Who the fuck are you, though? That's strong.
Let's all sing that, the chorus. I don't know how it goes, but...
Who are you? Yes,
ooh, 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 ooh. Ooh, who are you?
Remix.
I woke up in a storm.
All right, Steve Jones. Lonely
so
Boy is
fun.
The name of the book. It truly is a great listen in my case, and it certainly will be a good read.
I'm going to stay at your house when I come to Cali.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
Fool around.
I decided that.
Do some singing
out.
In the bathtub.
Yeah, I bring Carl. We do some cooking.
Check out his Instagram for real. It's Jonesy's Jukebox, right?
Jonesy's Jukebox.
On Instagram. Let's get him some followers today, although he's got plenty, but it's a good one to follow.
It's been a pleasure,
real.
Man.
Yeah, nice to meet you, man. Really. Thanks for doing the show.
Absolute pleasure.
We're going to take a quick break. We'll be back. Thank you to Steve Jones from the Sex Pistols.
Thank you.